what would that look like in oncology if they were starting to bundle certain kinds of, you know, stage one, stage two breast cancer or early stage colon cancer and provide bundled payments to providers to take care of those patients? And my reference to the orthopods was that they basically unilaterally announced that they were going to bundle the payments for hips and knee replacements. Yeah. Not as a pilot, which is how they've rolled out these bundles in the past, but basically for everyone.
Right.
And
right.
So it does demonstrate that CMS is willing to step very aggressively into these payment bundles.
Right. I would say for cancer, there's already been this kind of exploration around, you know, bundling cancer. There's always a very attractive kind of notion of bundles can solve everything. I think that you saw through the actual kind of BPCI, the bundle program within CMS, that it's not that easy to bundle oncology. Radiation oncology may make sense. There's certain discrete cases that may make sense. Certainly MD Anderson is trying to do, you know, head and neck. There's people around the country that are looking and doing private sector bundles. But for Medicare, I think it's going to be very difficult for them to just say, let's take all of oncology, like orthopedics, and bundle it, which is why you see Medicare doing the pilot that they're doing, which is essentially kind of a, you know, patient-centered oncology medical home with some of the shared savings components to it. So I don't think you'll see Medicare mandating any sort of oncology bundle anytime soon, because they have, I think, by doing this other kind of payment model, they're already saying we want to do something else.
I think you're so right, Kavita, because if you look at it, we talk about cancer, it's not the same as basically, you know, dialysis. We're talking about, you know, 254 different types of cancer, and mm-hmm. you're looking at adjuvant, metastatic, mm-hmm. you have all these combinations. And, you know, the bottom line is, I think there is a lot of movement towards let's look at some pilots and areas, and we've certainly seen in the private sector happening all across the country in terms of bundles. But I think the ability to Medicare to pull off bundles, even in some of the top cancers, I mean, I think that's, you know, way off into the future, if it ever. I think you mentioned a good point with the oncology care model, the OCM. I think they are actually trying to create a bundle without the drug, if you will.
Right.
They're putting the administration in. They're actually very smart because they don't have access to private payer data, but they will have access to John's data and if he's involved in the program and yeah. Aetna's and everybody else. But what's happened is I think they're trying to use that. A lot of people said, why did there's a sort of this artificial, you know, bundle and this artificial time period in it? And I believe because they want to look at that as the premise is, can they put the drug into that? But I think putting the drug into that is going to be very difficult, if not impossible.
It's interesting because I would disagree with both of you, although you're closer to it than I am. Both of you are in the policy and the politics of this, because my view is that it's going to be so administratively difficult for them to try to engage in some kind of risk-sharing arrangement outside of a bundled arrangement that they're going to default to that, because they know how to transfer risk,
sure,
but they don't know how to measure outcomes.
It. Sure,
right?
I agree with that. The only reason I think that the time horizon is too complex or too distant is because, let's take the orthopedics ones. I mean, they've already had to even delay the mandatory. I mean, they were supposed to launch the CCJR, CJCR on January 1st, and they pushed it back to April.
Well,
so I think there's an implementation delay, certainly, even when you have kind of a well-constructed bundle or the implementation of a bundle. But then I think that cancer, remember, this goes back to how much are we also fundamentally changing the Medicare program through this process? Bundling cancer care, I think one could argue that would be such a fundamental shift of kind of what beneficiaries see, that I think there would be great pause even within an administration that might be interested in doing it.
And I think you're right, Scott, that may be sort of the default, but I don't think they have the ability to carry off the default. So I think that sounds good, except if you realize in terms of what they can actually do operationally or not, and I think they can't do it. And the other thing I wanted to mention is, I think John has a point. If you look at on the oncology space, and we'll be talking more about that, there's a real interest on sort of the community practices to innovate and do things, because frankly, the reimbursement system isn't working right now. It's putting it on the hospital. The hospitals don't have that much incentive, and I think that's what your point is, John,
right,
especially on the drug side, where, you know, they have 340B discounts, you know, my favorite topic, and they literally are, they don't have that same pressure to try to innovate. So actually, when you see the innovation happening, and John, correct me, I mean, there's Priority that had the first oncology medical home contract in the country. And the bottom line is that we're seeing more innovation in the community space rather than in the hospital. And I think it is because there's more of a sense of urgency than not.